Welcome to the A New Narrative podcast, where we discuss all things health and human design. I'm Sam Zagar, your projector guide and host. This is a show about deconditioning. My goal is to confront our conditioned, not self narratives so that we can write them anew through the lens of our true selves. It's through this process that I hope to guide you to your signature life. Okay, welcome back to A New Narrative, and we are going to be talking to Jess Gelvin today. Now, Jess and I can relate on something in a way that is entirely opposite. We are people on very different ends of a specific kind of spectrum, in particular, variable. I'm a quad left, she's a quad right. We have other things in common, and we have some other differences, like we're both conscious third lines. She's a 3-5, I'm a 3-6. But she is a pure MG and I am a splenic projector. Other things we have in common are we are both parents. We're both stoners. I would say we both have a love of gardening. And we're going to uncover a few other things here. But those are the things that draw me to your content. I watch, so your stories are now, they've moved up to, I think you make it into the top five stories that I wake up to every morning. I like watching you start your day. It's almost like I can vicariously live through your ritual. We have some common things, like when I see you barefoot out in the yard, I'm like, oh, she must not have, you know, as many rocks or dog poop or whatever going on in my yard. Like, there's a reason that I'm not barefoot in my garden. I'm tactile weird. Like, the idea of having to wash my feet in between coming in and out of the house is like a thing for me, but I find it really regulating to watch you barefoot in your garden. We're both very into carnivore diets, although we have different determinations and there is no carnivore determination. So we've got some things to unpack there. Really, this is going to be like two good friends shooting the shit about their everyday life through human design mechanical awareness, and let's go for it. So welcome, Jess.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I love everything you were saying. I'm like, yeah.
Let's get you started with, I want to know for the audience a little bit about how they can visualize your life. So they're telling, as you're telling the stories, like, I've already communicated, you have garden, you have chickens, you got a big backyard, you're American.
Yep.
All right. Give me a little like.
Yeah, sure. So yeah, I live in New Hampshire and I have a son who's 11 and my husband, I think we've like been together 15 years. Not really sure. Somewhere in there. So we live in New Hampshire and I've got chickens. I've got dogs. We've got beautiful yard, which is something that brings me so, so much joy. I wasn't into gardening at all until, I don't know, maybe about 7-8 years ago, I started getting into it. I remember growing up, my mom would garden. I'd always be like, what the fuck are you doing? Like, this is so weird. Like, but I was a kid that definitely played in the woods. I made all the potions. I did all the stuff as a kid. So it made sense that when I settled down and was in a safe, loving relationship in a great home, I was able to really tap into these absolute passions of mine and really third-lined my way through learning how to garden and have a yard and everything. I just posted some things recently about what my yard looked like. It was about 7 years. Did you see that? Yeah. And it really, because it was like about 7 years ago and I was like, holy shit, like it's 7-year deconditioning you go through. And I think of my yard and what it looks like now compared to 7 years ago. So it was this beautiful like recognition of like, holy shit, like look how far I've taken this place. A little bit of work every day. Like, but it is, the gardening is so regulating to me. You know, they have studies about like soil has, you know, antidepressants in it. Like the smell of dirt, like does something different to your brain, just all these things. And I think also just creating life, like that's fucking cool. You take a seed and then you get a plant and you eat the food from the plant. Like how cool is that? I love how everything connects. Like we have chickens, we use the chicken manure in my compost that feeds my garden that then I eat. Like there's a whole circle of life happening and just our, you know, we have 5 acres, but it just feels like a whole world to me. Like this is my safe zone. This is where I can truly be myself, unmask, and like connect with myself. Like I can't really do anywhere else. And it has been, you know, this steady growth. It's been a little bit of work every single day to create this life that we have now. You know, I'm very different now than I was 5, 6, 8, 2 years ago. You know, all of it has changed, and I love looking back and seeing like the progression of all my different selves, you know, all my not selves in there with my true self trying to guide throughout everything, and then like really taking in the information of human design and where that's taken me. It's just, you know, it all connects for me. I know some, maybe other people don't see that, but like everything connects. Everything is important and special and meaningful to me.
This is a busy conversation. I was like, just on that answer, I got like 12 different questions that I want to ask. And I know that like the one I choose will continue to guide us in a certain direction. But in general, what I like the most about what came through there is a somewhat slow but consciously aware experience of you being in this home, changing the landscape of the home, changing the landscape of your relationship, changing your relationship to yourself. The word unmasking came up a couple of times. So I'm curious, will you share the process of what you're unmasking, and can we bring any of the human design mechanics? Like maybe this is how you used to present and you recognized how that wasn't part of your true self. What are you
Yeah,
unmasking?
totally. So I talk about with like coaches and stuff that I feel like most of my life I was living as a quad left ego manifester. Like that's how I was living. But like was also really applauded for it and like recognized for like I just was nonstop go do everything. Prior to COVID, I went through this process of like going through intentionally throughout everything in my house. I had collected shit over the years, and like it had started to pile up, and it got to a place where I was like, I can't live like this. Something needs to change. And I ended up going through every single space in my house and getting rid of everything that I didn't like, didn't make me happy, whatever, and kept everything I did, organized my entire house. And through doing that, I realized, holy shit, like, I feel so much better. Like I lifted, like there was, you know, external clutter, but there was this internal clutter that was just like lifted. And doing that, I was like, I know other people feel like me. I know other people, there's other ADHDers out there that like experience this and so I was like, I'm gonna make a business out of this. And it just so happened during that time, there was a woman who had put out that she was doing an organizing, like how to become an organizer. It was like a 6-month program. And I was like, absolutely cool. Did that, started a business, started organizing business, and started helping people with their homes and clearing the shit out. And what transformed in these people's lives was really something beautiful. And I just loved so much. But there was this pressure I would put on myself to always have to have everything together, to have everything perfect and organized and all these things. And so, because I was like, well, I have an organizing business, so I have to be perfect all the time. Like, I have to know my shit. I have to have everything done. I have to have the systems. And, you know, I was around a lot of left brain people, very strategic people. And I was like, these people know what they're talking about. They've got the systems. They're doing it, right? So I really lived in that for a few years of like putting all this pressure, not to mention the pressures of home and, you know, being a mom and running a household and taking care of animals and my husband and all these things of putting this pressure of having to have everything down, perfect, strategic, blah, blah. And it just got to a point where I was like, I can't live like this anymore. Like I felt like I was suffocating a part of me deep down inside. I wouldn't, it was like I trapped a version of myself deep inside, and I wouldn't let her out because I was like, no, you're not safe out here. People are not going to like you. You need to be X, Y, and Z. You need to be strategic. You need to have these things going. You need to be this way, right? This is what you're recognized for. People always look at you and all this stuff. Look at everything you can do and da da da. That's where I was getting my, you know, almost like my dopamine is like people telling me, oh, you're so great at doing this and great at doing that. Meanwhile, on the inside, I'm literally fucking dying. And so through a lot of that was like, you know, I ended up, so I was diagnosed with ADHD when I was, I don't know, God, 27, yeah, something like that, 26, 27, and was put on medication. And was, I remember the first time I took ADHD medication, I cried to my husband and I was like, is this how people feel? Is this how people go through life every day? Like stuff is just this easy. Like you can just do this and not have a complete meltdown. Like it was this huge, like weight had lifted off of me. Like, oh my God, like look at all I can do now. I can like excel at everything and I can get all the chores down and run the business and be a mom and run all the, I can do all of this now. And I lived that way for 8 years. I stayed on medication for 8 years and was, there was always this voice inside me being like, I don't think this is right. I don't think, and I was like, no, we have to do this. Like, look, we're able to do all this stuff. We have to keep doing this so we can function with our life. I remember when my doctor was putting me on the meds, she had said to me, one thing patients will sometimes describe when they start this, I was on Adderall, is they feel like they lose their spark. And I was like, bitch, what are you talking about? I'm sparking all over the place. I'm cleaning my house. I'm doing my laundry. Like I am getting all this stuff done. What do you mean spark? I was like, whatever. So about 8 years later, I decided to get off my medication. And the reason being is, well, for years and years of researching neurodivergence of, my son was in occupational therapy for like 4 years. So I got to really get a close and look at, OTs dealing with all kinds of neurodivergent children. I really kept getting these hits of like, there's more to this. It's not just ADHD here. Like there's more here. And I reached out to some people, got some references, and was going to get an autism diagnosis. So for the autism diagnosis, I really wanted to be as close to my true self as possible. And so coming off that medication was why I did that, was because I knew that that medication made me somebody else. And though that somebody else like could get a bunch of shit done and literally save the world, she was killing the deep person inside of me. And that's who I needed to come out. That's who I needed to be at the forefront of this. This is who I was like, I need my answers for her. And so a few weeks before my assessment, I stopped taking Adderall and went through the autism diagnosis. Yep, you're autistic. That was a whole other unmasking that happened during that time. Really, that was probably my biggest unmasking process, was getting that confirmation that I was autistic. It really let me let down all the things that I've been trying to hold up for so many years, so much of my not self. And when I look at, you know, my open centers, and when I look at, you know, a lot of that, I see my not self playing out, and I see, you know, how much I was truly struggling, especially as a quad right and then very left world. You know, I struggled so hard with strategery and structure and all of that, but that's what this world loves, and that's what you get praised for. And so understanding the neurodivergence, understanding the human design aspect, understanding my trauma and upbringing, I think that's all important to bring in, because that brings out our not selves as well. Really honing in on all these different modalities and understanding myself on a deeper level was really who, when I got to pull that girl out, and like she got to come front. And that's when I started realizing what my doctor said about losing your sparkle. because for the first time, I felt it. I felt the sparkle. I was like, oh, there she is. Like, oh, hey, like I thought you weren't real. So it's been a process. It's been, 10 years of it, but it really has, the diagnosis transformed so much for me. Finding out I was a quad right transformed so much for me, like really understanding like, oh, okay. Like all those things that I keep in and hold back because I feel they're not okay or not accepted. That's actually the stuff I'm here for. Like I'm here to get that shit out. Like I'm here to talk about that stuff, you know?
Okay, when you, so I, like, I'm always going to listen to the personal, being personal view, I'm always going to listen to this, and I see what I can relate to, what I can't relate to, and late diagnosis for ADHD, I was 33 when I got mine, they started me with Adderall, I was not told about losing my spark, I was told I would lose my appetite, which is interesting, especially being an appetite determination. Adderall had a really fast onset and a really fast offset that was like 6 to 8 hours long. And when it would drop, it's like the day's not over. You know, from 2 p.m. to 8 p.m. or 2 p.m. to 10 p.m., it was like I was double crashing coming down from it. And I would get like all this, it was like the symptoms were kept at bay, not dealt with. And then the floodgates would open in the evening. So then to manage those symptoms, I was smoking significantly more weed. But then there was the combination of being on a stimulant all day plus smoking weed that was elevating my heart rate. So this wasn't necessarily better for me either. Now, when we're unmasking, as in allowing ourselves to behave in natural ways that we blocked other people off from witnessing most of our lives, because you were masking, you weren't recognized by others in certain qualities. Somebody didn't come to you and say, I think that you're autistic because of this behavior. You're saying to yourself, I'm overmanaging my behaviors. And if I were to just act like myself, I think I might present to someone who's autistic. So what were the first things that you started to recognize as in, I might be autistic? And then when you got the diagnosis and you were unmasking further, were there ways in which, like, did you have any preconceived notion about how autism is supposed to present or how people might? Part of what I'm trying to say here has to do with the fact that you're an attractive woman. So being an attractive woman, I think, makes it way fucking harder to get any kind of diagnosis. But how did you let yourself show up differently in a way that could be identified as autism?
Yeah, great question. So I had notions of being autistic actually very young. There was always like a feeling inside of me. I remember in high school saying to one of my friends, and like autism like wasn't a thing in my high, like that wasn't like a thing. You didn't really know anyone with autism or like any of that. But for some reason, I just was like, I think I'm autistic. And I remember my friend being like, what the fuck are you talking about, Jess? Like, okay, whatever. As the years went on, I would get these, like now when I feel like, I would get sacral hits about it. Like when autism would come up, I'd be like, I feel that. I feel that. When my son was in OT for 4 years, I went to every single OT. I sat in hundreds of hours of OT sessions with him and got to witness a lot. I got to see a lot of kids with autism and how they go through and what they experience. And I got to listen to the language that the OTs would use. And I would just so deeply resonate to everything that, how they were talking to them, how they would show them how to manage their emotions and things with my son. A lot of the techniques that we learned were so helpful for me, like so helpful. I was like, we'd be coming home with these charts and things on how to regulate our emotions and how to do all this stuff. And I was like, this is great. This is the best parenting advice I've ever had in my life. Like, holy shit. And then there was like, you know, I think social media is such a gift in ways like this, because I'm interested in neurodivergent content. So what do I get? I got a lot of women neurodivergent popping up on my feed and listening to their stories and like really resonating with a lot of stuff they're saying. and really just getting these sacral hits about it. And it was just maybe all this time, like, there wasn't something wrong with me. Like, maybe it wasn't like I'm the issue and there's like problem. Like, maybe it's something else. Like, I always felt like I have to work so hard to do things that people just do naturally. Like, things are so hard for me. And like, I mask that. I don't let people know because of fear of looking a certain way or being belittled or put down or whatever in there. But like, I got to a point where I felt like it was killing me. Like, that's the only, like, that's what comes up when people are like, I was like, I just felt like I was dying. And I don't mean to be like dramatic about it, but like, I was just suffocating this natural part of me that wanted to talk, to move, to be, to say, to like, in the way that she just naturally wanted to do those things, instead of constantly feeling I had to like stop my stimming or not sway back and forth or say the shit that comes out of my mouth because everyone told me I was too blunt or rude or bitchy. I would hold all that stuff in. I would get these sacral hits about stuff and not say it because I was like, oh, someone's gonna be upset. All this stuff I would just hold in, and it was killing me. And it was just to a point where I was like, what do I have to lose by doing this? What do I have to lose? And I went into it very informed because of the internet and other women going before me and listening to their stories. I understood how fucking hard it is for women to get a diagnosis. I understood how hard it is for doctors to take you seriously because women present differently. We don't have any research on women because it's just being done now. We don't have research on how it shows up like we did with boys. All the research that was done on autism was done in boys, young white boys. So that's what we have for research. So because I don't, you know, boys are a little more hyperactive in how they present, girls internalize their symptoms. We're excellent maskers. And so I started hearing all these things and just being like, yes, that's exactly what I do. That's exactly what I do. That's how I feel. That's like, so I was very prepared going into my diagnosis, and it was actually a horrible experience. I kind of knew it was going to be, I was prepared for it because I knew that it's just, there hasn't been enough time out yet for these neuro doctors to have the understanding that I have. I honestly, this is going to sound cocky, but I thought I knew more about autism. Like, I know more about autism than that man did. And it was very obvious in just how some of the things he would say. And it was a total gaslighting experience, actually. But I went through it and I was like, I knew this, me going through this and it being hard was going to be important so that I could share my knowledge with the next person so that maybe their experience could be a little bit different so that maybe they could feel validated in their experience as a woman. Because yes, there's definitely I get the most common thing I get is, you don't look autistic. You don't look like, well, autism doesn't have a look, dude.
You know, like,
right.
It's so, not autism. Yeah. Like there's no visual identification.
Exactly. And so that just shows me your ignorance in the spectrum. Like, so, okay, cool. So let's like get you educated on it. It doesn't have a look. It's not a one size fits all. It is a spectrum. That means there are dozens, if not hundreds of different experiences that exist in that spectrum. And you could be over or under stimulated in any of those. You may need more or less of something. You might fall in the middle of something else. It is a spectrum. Each autistic person is different and experiences their autism different. And I think that is something that anything I want people to just get that is that autism looks different in every single person. And once you start seeing that, then you can start really fully seeing the person and not just your perception of what you think autism is.
Is there anybody's account you come across where they specifically use the language of unmasking to replace the language of deconditioning?
I feel I can't give you specific, but I do feel like a lot of the times when I read that stuff, I see it both ways. I can absolutely see deconditioning and unmasking happening. And then there are things that I think just exist. Like, that's something I always kind of toy with, because I love looking at neurodivergence through a human design lens, because I think it's fascinating.
I got a fun question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody lived a true self life, would we all present as neurodivergent?
I think that I said to people all the time that I was like, I'm pretty sure that there's not a neurotypical person that exists in our world anymore. I don't think there is. Like, I don't think anyone is neurotypical. Like, I just don't. Right? And that's so, yeah, I do, like, and that's, I think, why awareness of this is so fucking important. Because, like, okay, yes, I'm neurodivergent, but so are you, and so are you, and so are you. And so just, like, learn what that is. It's like a full spectrum. There's so much that goes into it. And then you can, like, better know yourself on a much deeper level when you just understand the spectrum of neurodivergence. It feels very obvious to me, but I understand it's not that way to most people.
When you were talking about ADHD and you were talking about the spark, when I first heard it, I think I heard the spark as a way of meaning like an energy, like it brought an energy to you. Because for me, it's not, I don't find energy like from a bottom up level. I only feel energy in the sense of clarity. Suddenly my executive functioning changes. And it's not that I have more energy. It's actually more so that I don't waste the energy that I actually do have, because I can prioritize where it's supposed to go. But the more that you talked about it, what I really heard there was you're not referring to the spark as energy. You're talking about the spark as uniqueness. Like, it diminished what made you special. And so I've kind of been looking at that for myself, like, one, I couldn't stay on Adderall. I made it like 2 weeks, and then I had to switch to Vyvanse because it's longer and calmer.
Yeah.
And it's also a mood regulator. There's some little other benefit there. I also love the question of, if everything in my life was set up to support me in my design, would I need the medication? You know, let's just say right off the bat, I don't need my medication. Not taking my medication does not put my life at risk at all. I do not need my medication. I choose to take my medication on the days that I remember to. That's a funny thing. On the days that I remember my meds, I take my meds. And there is a level of lightness, clearness. And I wouldn't necessarily say that. It's interesting. Attention deficit hyperactive disorder. Hyperactive disorder. When I really think about that, I'm like, the disorder is the fact that the hyper part doesn't attach to productivity. That's the disorder. So it's like, they should call it like ADHP, attention deficit hyperproductive, because that's what they're trying.
Yeah.
Right? Like, it's a product solution.
It's very interesting. I, like I said, I was on a medication for 8 years. It changed my life. It really did help me in so many ways. It also hurt me in so many ways. And I think the conditioning of the world is what puts that pressure. 100% would put the pressure on me to stay on it, because I was like, I can only be productive when I do. Productive according to society's standards, right? According to that way of life. My son was diagnosed with ADHD, and I remember his doctor being like, oh, well, like, let me know if you want to medicate. And I was like, oh, no, absolutely not. When I got on that medication, I remember thinking, there's no way in hell I would ever give this to my child. Like, there's no way in hell I would ever do this. I needed it because I had to function and, like, get our life going. But I was like, I would not put this type of pressure on my son. If this isn't the way he's meant to naturally be, why am I going to force that in him. Like, no, absolutely not. We will work on emotional regulation. We'll work on tools. We'll work on this, da, da, da. But it's like, the more, I think diagnosis is great. It's so affirming. It's beautiful. But I don't think that the first thing should be like, here's a pill to make you productive. Like, I don't think that's the first thing that should be done when diagnosis happens. I think we need a lot more fucking education on it and how to manage it and how that looks for you. And I think it's so individualized, just like human design. Like, your neurodivergence is so individualized to you, and you have to learn how it shows up for you and ways to manage that. And then, like, yes, if you need medication, like, go for it. But, like, at first, give someone the tools to manage it without, because I felt so stuck on it. I was like, I remember being like, there's no way, how am I ever going to come off this? Like, look what I've created. I'm literally responding to everything and trying to create everything all at once because I have the ability to do it. But that wasn't natural. It's not a natural state. Like, people don't naturally act like that. Like, that's not normal. And that's certainly not how I wanted to be a role model for my son. Like, that's not the type of woman I want him to have, someone that's constantly going and pouring herself out and doing and being. Like, that's not healthy for anybody. So it's like, there's so much education, I think, that needs to be done. There's so much more understanding that needs to be done. I don't think medication should always be the first way to go. Like I said, it changed my life. It helped me, but it also hurt me. And so I think having access to tools and other ways and, you know, modalities that help you connect with that part of you is more important, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. I think when we're looking at, like, so much of this is mental, right? Like, we're thinking about how the mind works.
Mm-hmm.
And yet there's a very physical component to this in how energy presents in somebody's body. My son has a 3-5 pure MG. He's obviously, he's an active energy type.
Yeah.
And I can see that he has some of the same issues that I did that led me to be diagnosed for ADHD. Like, hyper focus that leads us to, you know, burn something on the stove because we forgot we were cooking because we got distracted by a YouTube commercial or something, right? Like, it. And so I'll say things to him like, you know, and he's strategic. It's like, okay, bro, I got to teach you to set timers on the microwave so you can hear the beep and your attention can be called back to what's, you can respond to that sound, right? Like, how do I play with his mechanics in a way that, what do I need to teach him about being in his body that might change some of this? Because he's very, very fidgety. I mean, the kid's a fucking very left MG, right? Like, he's very motored. He's got lots going on. And so when he's presenting with all of this energy, if my solution was to medicate him down in his energy rather than actually have him spend his sacral energy in a way that exhausts him so that he can, it's like, little boys don't need medicine. They need double the amount of playtime outside in between their academic subjects that cause them to be focused down like this. And even there, I'm like, I hate that I said boys. I absolutely hate anybody together in any kind of thing. But I do believe that it is more, and, you know, again, right there, I'm like, what if I have a quad right reflector boy, right? Like, he's clearly not going to be super energetic with everybody else. There are exceptions to everything.
Yeah.
But for the most part, you know, Maven, he needs his energy appropriately managed for what he is. Whereas I'm not an energy type. Like, when I present as hyperactive, we have to ask the question of, like, am I in a natural flow with my ego in my right environment with my active body? And is this the right level of stimulation coming out of me? Or am I amplifying the hell out of a bunch of other things? Am I running off with my root pressure? Am I trying to get all the things done and hoping my meds are going to help me get 20 more things done today? And I'll never actually know if, you know, fully, am I quad left or am I ADHD? Honestly, that's just a question that I have all the time.
Yeah.
You're unmedicated, but you do smoke weed.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
What else do
that
you
is
or
yeah.
regularly do?
So I smoke weed and I microdose on mushrooms. That actually, microdosing on mushrooms is what got me off of my Adderall. And it has been the number one help in my overall mental health more than anything else. I've been medicated since I was like 13 years old on every antidepressant, every anxiety, everything you can think of. Mushrooms has been the thing that's it. Mushrooms. I could just be mushrooms and weed. That's it. Just send me in the forest. See you later. I've never had, and I'm not saying they're right for everybody, but that is what helped me immensely. And still to this day, I use cannabis every day as a tool to help with a lot of the, I experience a lot of sensory issues. I experience a lot of stuff in my body. Weed does not affect my mind, my head. 99% of the time, I will be high and you won't know it. Like, you won't know it. Because for me, it's all about the body and what it does for my body and helps me like relax. I hold like, there's a lot of, I have a lot of energy in me. Like, it exists. And so being a quad right, having a ton of energy and needing to be receptive and passive and like flow through life, that's why like I realized these morning rituals of getting outside, watering my garden, making some cannabis coffee, like these very intentional regulating things is how I've had to build my life, because there's a lot in here going on all the time and I need to like extend it out throughout the day. You know, I've got to be a mom all day long. I've got to caregive and all this stuff. So I've had to learn how to manage and appropriately take care of this energy and how to use it in a way that feels good as opposed to like just being active and going all the time. So cannabis helps me get into my body. Mushrooms help me get into my body and helps me connect with myself on all the dimensions that like I live in. I feel there's like times where I'm like no to mushrooms. I'm like nope, not right now. And there's times where we're ready. We need mushrooms. Like we need to be microdosing this week. Or maybe we like I last week it was like my body was like we need a little higher. We need to do a dose. So I did a little bit higher microdose and felt the whole thing and like experienced so much like moving. I feel like a lot of times my body is like processing out stuff or like we're rejuvenating and the new is coming in. It's like, okay, let's bring the mushrooms in to help that process go, to help integrate, to help what is the work we've been doing the past 6 months, the past 3 months, the past few weeks. Like, let's integrate that deep. I feel like that's what mushrooms help me do. And the gratitude that I feel on mushrooms isn't like anything else. If people just take it just to experience that. The smallness of life, the littlest things I can have this insane appreciation for, to the point where I'm like crying looking at a fucking tree. I'm like, look at this. This is so, but like I experience like such an emotional reaction to life and like how lucky we are to fucking be here. The chances of us being here is astronomical. It's huge numbers, right? And that we come into this life, we're instantly conditioned, and then we live through society's ways of blah, 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 and go through life. And then we're 40, 50 years old being like, what the fuck have I been doing my whole life? I want people to have that awareness much sooner. Like, and I feel like mushrooms can do that. I truly believe that mushrooms can save the world. I feel like mushrooms can bring us back into our bodies. There's so many studies out there about what it does for people with PTSD. Like, the research is, you know, we had to stall research for 30 years, but now it's like coming back again. I'm like, this is it. This is the answer. It's not the pharmaceuticals. Like, it's not.
There's a funny line from Ra where he says, people who are not self are just furniture. And I think it's r really funny.
That's
We're basic,
so
it's a
great.
way of saying you're not alive. When you're not self, you're not alive. Most people, when they do mushrooms, they want to go outside. They want to be in nature, you know, in that sense of like connecting to the tree and feeling overwhelmed with emotion or awareness. It's like you tapped into, you know, a life frequency. It's like being able to see new colors in the rainbow that you couldn't see before. And what gets me every time is the awareness of like, this is existing whether I'm high on mushrooms or not. But being high on mushrooms gives me the ability to participate in it, to be aware of it, And it really reminds me that, like, without that, a lot of what sucks about life is that there's no life. It's dead. You're inside. The furniture's dead. If you're not self, you're dead furniture, right? You're really not living your life. But when you're living your life and you're connected to life, like, that feels way more purposeful to me. You know, as I'm, you know, I laugh that I could take pictures of my place from almost 6 years ago, and it was just a hard gravel lot. We all had to develop and landscape our own places. And so I'm probably going to look for a picture of my place from 6 years ago where it's just gravel. I got like one dead tomato in one tiny little pot in a gazebo, right? So for a little shade in my rock land, and how I've established things over the years. And I work in my garden hours a day, every day right now. And people ask me, like, well, what's the plan? Like, what are you putting in? What are you growing? I'll go to the plant store and it's like, what are you going to get? I'm like, I have no fucking idea what I'm going to get. I'm just going to the plant store right now because that's the flow that I'm in. But it's not about, it's not about creating a dead landscape, right? Like, it's not about the deck and the chair so I can sit there and do nothing. Like, I'm playing in my yard because I'm playing in my yard. That's the point. All the garden beds I've made, they have like rocks and logs around the edge because when I change my mind next year, 5.3, the gardener that's got a trial and error process, right? Like, I'm just going to pull all those rocks away, add more dirt, extend the garden by 2 feet or whatever. But it's about being in the flow of life. That's the purpose for me. It's not completing this thing. It's like every day, what's the flow? You know, the weather controls the flow, the however my schedule gets booked. You know, so many things out of my control control my flow, and being allowed to be in my flow, that's what feels like I'm actually living my life. I'm curious how you do your mushrooms. As a closed taste person, do you have a specific way that you like to take your mushrooms?
Yeah, so I've experimented with different things. And what I have found is I take capsules. That's the, because I've tried different taste ones and it was like gagging immediately. I was like, no, I can't do it. So mine are in capsules, which is very easy for me to take. And that's my go-to for taking them. Yeah, anything with the taste stuff is like an out. I've tried chocolate, I've tried wafers, I've tried my, I'm just like always like, nope. The capsule is the way to go. How do you take them?
I'm laughing so much. I'm like, as a consecutive person, I'll just pop it in my mouth and chew it, right? Like, yeah, I just suck on it like candy. Yeah. And it's just mushroom. Yeah. And I don't just like mushrooms. But my girlfriend makes capsules of all different kinds. Yeah. But I don't take the capsule. I can't handle everything hitting me at once. I'm a sipper. Okay. So I will break the capsule into a cup of tea. And then how fast I drink that cup of tea depends on how fast I want to get to a certain level. But I find that there's a big difference between receptive people who do mushrooms and strategic people who do mushrooms. So, like, mushrooms are not my favorite. Like, I smoke weed most of the day, every day, but I can do mushrooms occasionally. And it's such an intuitive thing. Like, I'll realize I'm just grabbing the jar down and it's like, oh, I guess we're just doing mushrooms right now. Exactly. Must mean something. Yeah. You know, the other day I walked, took a capsule, totally swallowed it, and then 5 minutes later I was like, oh my god, I thought that was a B vitamin. Fuck, we're about to be high. And it just worked out that I had the afternoon to myself and went into the garden and just had the greatest fucking time. I like to just pop them open that way. I don't like drops or tinctures or anything. I find those are too, like, they're too denatured from the product to me.
Yeah.
What else was coming through that I wanted to talk about today? We talked about parenting. We talked a little bit about weed. We talked about some fun, different directional neural things. Is there anything that you want to talk about?
Okay. Yeah, I feel like so much came up. I'm like, where does it want to go? Oh, you were just talking. Okay. So how do you feel like with the quad, when you, as a quad left, you feel like different with the mushrooms? Like, how do you experience that versus like quad right? How do you feel like it's different? I know we've talked about that because you've said, like, I think even Roz said something about quad left. Maybe you shouldn't do it, but I'd love to hear your experience with it
I think
or
that
what it
mushrooms
does for you.
make me
Sorry.
more right. I think that the left uses mushrooms to experience rightness because the peripheral view opens up, the awareness opens right up. I can no longer focus the way that I used to. Working on mushrooms is weird. I have the automatic thought that I can't work on mushrooms, so I don't. But there have been a few times where once I'm high, I grab my laptop and I start working on something. And it's weird. It's almost like I'm not there. I'm not in my body. Like it's just happening. And I'm like, this is really cool. Like it's almost like snowboarding or longboarding or something really fast. And you're like, don't bail, don't bail, don't bail. It's gonna hurt so, you're doing so well, you know? But it's hard for me to like I'll freak out. And tactile stuff kicks on for me. So microdosing is totally cool. Love it, feels great. Proper dosing, I'm really tactile, weird. I can't touch my hair. As soon as I touch my hair, I have this feeling that my hair is the bottom of the forest floor and it's full of bugs.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
I don't know why, but it's just like
Interesting. Yeah. There's like
I
an awareness of like how things feel. Like I was just saying the other day when I microdose, I can feel my teeth. Like
Yeah.
they're like throbbing in there. And I'm like, oh my God, they're like alive and I feel them. It's so, but yeah, I understand that with the hair, there's like, yeah, you have like an awareness of like the energy that exists within it. I think it's pretty
Oh,
cool.
it's got to be braided. I got to have my headphones on. I can't be my focus at all. Like, I literally just have to be in the flow. I will say, I had a shared experience with someone on mushrooms once where we went for a walk and we weren't even that high, but we walked down the road we lived on. We'd done this so many times. But as we turned to go to the next street and there were telephone lines going over this street, it's like we walked along the telephone lines. Then I had to turn and go under them. And as soon as I turned, you know, when you're playing with bubbles, like bubbles have that rainbow kind of gas look on top of them. It was like a bubble went from the top of the telephone poles to the ground, and it had that like glassy rainbow kind of look. And what I stopped and I looked and I was like, do you see that? And they were like, the force field. And I was like, you see it too. Like,
Oh
okay,
shit.
we both see the force field. My favorite part of this is what I did next, because I've done many things in my life where in retrospect I'm like, you idiot, like why would you do that? You're the girl in the horror movie that dies first, you know? But I saw the force field and I couldn't help myself. I was just like, whoa, like I stuck my hand
Want to
into it
touch
right away.
it.
Third line, right? Like, how hot is it? Is it gonna kill me? Is it gonna burn me? Like, where am I gonna go? Is this a portal? Is this like
Where am I going?
all that happened was I could put my arm through it and I could pull my arm back
Nothing.
out. I was just like, this is fucked up.
Could you like see it going through it?
Yep.
Could you feel anything, or was it
Nope.
just like a visual? Yeah. Oh,
It,
it's so
but they saw
beautiful.
it too. And I was like, okay,
Yeah.
when the other person sees it too, and you haven't described it to each other, there is more to see. Just because we can't see it doesn't mean it's not there. And that is so not a God conversation. It's
Oh yeah,
definitely
no.
a frequency and energy conversation.
Totally. 100%. I totally, that's like exactly what when I take mushrooms at a higher dose, that's what I feel like. I feel like they're, we talk about the veil pulled over our eyes. I truly feel it. Something is lifted and the conditioning of our world, you can see all the beautiful that exists. Like I will see like I remember one time I was in my backyard and all of my trees, they all had geometric shapes and rainbows and number sequences in them. And it was like coding. Everything was coded. And I was like, oh, I got like my sacral was so even talking about right now, like it was so fucking cool. 'Cause I was like, look at all these numbers and geometric shapes and rainbows, and it's all connected, and there's all this coding and there's all this data that was just like out there. And I'm like, this is real, dude. Like, this is fucking real. And I think I can experience that stuff not on anything. Like, I can experience those type of experiences. That was something I definitely would dull down in myself, is like how I experience the world is very sensory wise. Like, my husband will joke about me because we'll be somewhere and I will get so fucking excited because I see a butterfly or a bee or like some little thing. But to me, like, there's this like magic beneath that. I'm like, holy shit, this isn't just a butterfly. This isn't just a bird. Like, there's so much depth for me in all of these intricate things. And I think when I take mushrooms, like, I experience that, but it's like safe. And like, oh, hey, this is how we operate on this level. You know, this is how things are here. And I'm like, oh, I'm home. Great. Thank you. So nice to be here. You know?
Okay. You reminded me of one question that I had actually from the beginning of the conversation. I am curious to know how your relationship changed, but it sounds like you've had the same partner for a long time. This partner has been with you through, let's call it, old you and unmasked you. How did your partner show up for you or hold space for you or evolve with you? Like, this didn't lead to the end of your relationship. So how did your partner help you? I'm only using him. I'm trying to stay out of the other keynotes because I don't know what his circuitry is.
Yeah. So my husband's name is Dan. I met him when I was like 20. I just come out of a terrible, terrible relationship, terrible everything, really, really bad when I first met him. And I think the biggest thing for me is like, Dan was the first man I'd ever met that was safe. And I couldn't experience that safety until probably just a few years ago in my body. But there was something about him that was always safe. And he met me at a very fucked up time in my life. Like, I really was put through the wringer right before we met. I had tried to take my own life and was in a mental institution and was bulimic and like, you name it, all the things. And I was living in Rhode Island at the time, and I ended up moving back to New Hampshire, where I'm from, and met him. And I remember we met at some party. We had a mutual friend. And I remember him walking through the door, and instantly when I look back, I know, I'm like, I felt it in my sacral. The second he walked in, I like felt it, but was like, no. You know, fast forward, we end up dating, we get married, we have a kid. And through all of that, I have been many different versions of myself. Many. My husband's a generator. He's a 1-3 generator. He's an emotional. He's also a quadruple split, which I think is kind of cool about him. But he's very much a generator. And I feel like he's always given that kind of stable energy to me that I never experienced prior to him. And little by little, by experiencing that safety and support and all of this in a man, which again, I had never experienced in my life before, every little bit, it just allowed a little more safety in my body, a little more, a little more, a little more. Like, this is the long game here. Like, we're 15 years in here and have been through all the things. But I truly feel like my husband saw me, the true self, me, way back then. And that's something I will always say to him. I'm like, well, not anymore. But in the past, I'd be like, how do you fucking deal with all of this? Like, there's a lot here. I have a lot going on. Like, and he's like, I know the real you through everything. He's like, I know who you are. I know your heart. Like, I feel that in you. And when I got my autism diagnosis, and I remember like that for me was the thing where I was like, oh, okay, I'm gonna shed all this shit now. But there was this fear because even though I felt safe and love him, I masked in front of him our whole relationship. There's things that he didn't get to see because I was afraid of showing them because I was like, this is fucking weird or this is whatever. And so when I got that diagnosis and I started letting these things down and started not being the person I was and doing all the stuff I was doing, there was a fear of like, oh, like he might not like this version. He might not like this, Jess. But again, there was just like that pull inside me. It was like, but this has to come. You have to be, this is who you are. Like, you have to let this out. And so I started like letting things down and not doing all the stuff I used to be doing and really showing a lot of like my sensory sensitivities and having more meltdowns and having more just asking for more accommodations, honestly, having way better conversations. I think that's something that really has helped me a lot is I would hold so much back. I have a completely open solar plexus. I am the queen of not wanting to have difficult conversations like my whole life. I would feel things instantly and be like, and have to hold them in because I was so scared to like voice truth in real time because so much backlash would always come at me. COVID was a great example of that, of like me wanting to have really difficult conversations, but nope, got to hold that in. Being diagnosed with autism has helped me get that out. It's helped me have those uncomfortable conversations. It's helped me ask for things in real time, ask for accommodations and how I need my needs met and how we can work together with that. And not that it's been easy, but my husband has been incredibly receptive towards it. And honestly, it's been such a gift because I think it's helped our relationship so much more because I can really have these uncomfortable conversations and let him know that, hey, this is bothering me. This is da 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 da. Like, and him come back with like, oh, I understand that. And I see that. How can we work this out? Or what can we do to blah, blah, blah. And that's like built up my strength to have more uncomfortable conversations with people in my life and creating boundaries around things and around people, friendships, relationships, all of that, where before I would just constantly give myself out and constantly be there for everyone and let people, the wrong people, pull from me. And now I'm way more discerning of that. And I think a lot of that is because in my practice and having these hard conversations with my husband about things like, and working through things together and like us fighting, but then coming to a resolution. I think one of the biggest things that I learned as an adult, and I think like the number one thing is repair. Like you can fuck up in a moment and then create repair. There's also shit you can fuck up and that needs to end. But I never saw repair happen growing up. I just thought like bad things happen and you don't talk about it. It goes under the rug. That's it. There's the trauma. I've learned through being my marriage and through parenting is that you can fuck up and then own your mistakes and share how you can do it differently and create a repair with that person. And so that is something that has been almost like takes so much pressure off my shoulders because I do have this pressure to like, I work really hard and want to be a really good mom. That's just something like I want to do. I want to be a really good, I want to have a really good, healthy relationship with my husband. I would see people getting married and constantly talking shit about their husbands or like complaining about their husbands. And I was always so confused by it because I was like, well, you're playing a part in this too, because you're not having a fucking conversation about what's not working here. Like you go and complain or you hate this, or you know, you don't let help with the kids, like you're creating this. And I didn't want that. I saw the way people were having relationships or the way people were parenting their kids, you know, how I grew up was very much that way. And I was like, I know things can be different. Like it doesn't have to be this way. And so it's really been a lot of just like these little practices, these little uncomfortable conversations, these little asking for accommodations, these little putting up boundaries, protecting myself, but in like an intentional way. But then having the other person reciprocate safety and love and understanding and repair, like that's where I think the healing and the integration comes, is there's this back and forth. it's not just an output. I'm not just like constantly asking for my needs to be met and nothing coming back. I'm asking for my needs to be met. He's meeting me and I'm meeting his needs, right? And then there could be conversations when those things don't work out, or maybe we hurt each other and we didn't know, or something is bothering us. Like, I like that we can have the conversation about it instead of sweeping it under the rug, because that's what I grew up on. And it was so hard. It was so confusing. And I was like, had to learn how to repair, I think is like such an important skill to have as an adult.
I'm glad that you used the word repair, and I'm glad you used it quite a few times, because I can relate to that so much. And there's three parts of your body graph where I really, really connect to that. Neither of us has a defined solar plexus. We both have defined spleens with a gate 44 channel, and we're both conscious third lines. So when I think about what just those three elements have done to our relationship, to repairing, especially conflict, avoiding truth and confrontation, this fear that my survival depends on not repeating past mistakes, and this third line personality that says, I'm going to fuck it up and break the bond. I'm going to fuck it up and break the bond. But I'm not learning that much in that process if I'm not trying again, trial and error, right? So like, our personality is not meant to be stuck in pessimism all the time, stuck in the, this isn't going to work. It never worked. It's going to fail again. Why bother talking about it? Like, that is a really negative side of me that can come out.
Mm-hmm.
Repair is, I've had to really humble my ego in order to get into certain repair conversations, because it took me so long to find my voice and put up good, reasonable, healthy boundaries against certain things, that it almost gets to a point where you start to wonder if you're dropping your boundaries, losing your boundaries. Are people crossing your boundaries? Should you be aggressive and put them back up? Is it safe to let these people in for this kind of conversation? Like, I'm an extremist. I go really hard one way, really hard the other way. No boundaries. Okay, tons of boundaries. And if you piss me off, you're on that side of the boundary now. And then, you know, a year later, when I can self-reflect on the fact that I still got this problem, but that person's not around causing it, I'm like, uh-oh, maybe this is a me thing. Maybe this is a we thing. Maybe I owe an apology. Maybe I was a little hasty. Maybe I... Mm-hmm. Not too many people set me up for how to repair my broken bonds with people. And if anything, for the most part, I almost get like extra conditioning that says, like, you put that boundary up for a reason, you know, you should feel shame if you go back to that, if you forget how bad that was, or if you, you know, oh, your self-esteem must be really low again if you're willing to go back into that experience with that person. It's like, or maybe there's growth to be had, maybe there's communion to be had, maybe I'm not perfect, right? Like, oh man, I've had to humble, and I don't like calling it ego death. I have no interest in killing my ego. I love my ego. But sometimes bitch needs to take a back seat to my spleen.
Yep. Totally.
I'm using you as an example because I'm not in a relationship, and the way that I've presented in my relationships has had different opinions from different people on my behavior. And truthfully, I don't know if I've ever been in a relationship where I've actually been myself in that relationship. I only have the awareness of like, whatever comes next for me, like you get to be a role model in a way for me. She's got a partner. They've been together for a long time. She's not saying it's perfect. She's saying issues come up. She's saying there's a need for repair, but we're doing it. We're getting through it. We're doing it as ourselves. That's inspiring for me.
Yeah. Honestly, it's like inspiring for me too. Like, I've never there was no relationships growing up where people were together. Like my parents were together. I didn't know anyone that had parents that were happily married. Like it didn't exist. I remember as a child, like saying to my mom that I want the white picket fence life. And I remember her telling me that doesn't exist. It's not real. And I remember in that moment, I was young, I was under 10. I remember in that moment, me being like, watch it, watch me, watch it exist. Like, you want to tell me it doesn't exist? I'm gonna fucking make it. And in my own way, I have created my own white picket fence life. Is that fence chipped and does it sometimes fall down? Absolutely. But I get out there and I fucking repair it, okay? I
Sometimes
fix
chickens
it.
break free.
Exactly. Sometimes shit happens with that fence, but I have spent over 10 years in many different types of therapy. I have done lots of work on myself. I have finally gotten to a point where all this work I feel like has paid off. I have the tools and the skills to be able to manage my emotions, to be able to express myself clearly, to be able to take my time away, to express when I need space, to express when I need nurturing and alone, whatever. There's also times that I fuck up and I don't do those things, and maybe we have a bump in the road and we've got to repair it. Like, all of that exists every day. Like, there's great moments and there's moments where I'm like, I want to fucking move out. Like, there's times where I love everything we have, and there's times where I want to run away. Like, all of it exists. Like, it's not always this great, perfect, but there's so much more happiness, understanding, satisfaction of the life I've created. And it feels more intentional than ever now. Before, I would like do things from like, oh, this is what you do. Like, in society, this is you get married, you have a kid, blah, 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 blah. And now I'm like, well, how the fuck do I want to live? Like, what's my life want to look like? What's my white picket fence want to look like? And I literally get to create it every single day. I can change it every day. I can fucking paint my fence black if I want. Like, I can do whatever I want. This is my life. And having tools and strategies and modalities and therapies and all that stuff has helped me get to that point where I am in my body and I listen to it now. I listen to it. It's not always right. I don't always get it right, but I listen to it more than ever. And in doing that, I have a more satisfied life. You
This is all I want to hear. Honestly, at the end of the day, this is all I want to hear from my conversations. Like, you live the life that feels good for you. You know, when we say that is correct, we don't mean that somebody else like gave you an A plus on your experiment. It's like, you know, there's a true self way, and you were willing, ego, to try third line to live this life because you'd exasperated most of the other options. And it turns out, you know, one of the last options that you had been avoiding by masking was actually the way to go. Okay, I'm gonna wrap it up here, but I want people to know how to find you to be able to work with you because you do human design readings. And I think that especially anybody that shares common definition with you, you've got a lot of great experience to share. It's not theoretical. It's you've lived this, which I appreciate. So, where can they find you?
I would just go on my Instagram, which is the quad right way. And I've got links there if you want to book sessions or anything like that. It's all right on my IG.
I love it. And I'm an avid story watcher. I strongly suggest anyone listening to this watch because it is regulating. Like, when I watch your stories, I don't feel like you haven't exacerbated any not self qualities in me. I don't feel under pressure to be inspiring. I don't feel under pressure to get shit done. I feel like it's okay for me to prioritize what will actually feel good and regulate me moment to moment. You're a good dose of medicine in the morning.
Thank you. I really appreciate that so much.
Of course. Thanks for coming on the podcast, Jess.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah.
Bye.